Good day everyone. Today we will discuss about the concept of failure and various theories of failure and the different ways in which a component or a system fails. Now let's first define what is failure. Every system or a machine or a component is expected to do a job, so that we call it as its intended job. It is supposed to do a job. So when it is not able to do that job, then we say that component or a system has failed. So that is the meaning of failure. Failure is anything which is responsible for the system not to function, we call it as failure. So more formally, we defined failure as change in size, shape or material property of a machine or a machine part that makes it incapable of performing its intended function. So it is not able to do its intended job because there is some change in size or some change in shape or some material property has changed. Because of these three things, it is not able to do its job. So then we say system has failed. So failure is basically linked with its functionality. For example, you may find an aeroplane wing is bent like this. Okay, it's a bent. It has not broken, but because it has got large deformation, you say it is not performing its job. Then we say it's a failure, even though the wing is still is unbroken. So it is nothing to do with whether a component is broken or not. Most probably, in most of the cases, when the component is broken, it is basically a failure. But if something is not broken, it doesn't mean that it has not failed. So let us redefine failure. Failure is something, it simply says it is not doing its intended job. Okay, so that's the meaning of failure. Now let us see a mode. Mode is a particular way or a way in which a component or a system fails. There are different ways a component can fail. So each particular type is called a mode. So there are hundreds of modes in which a component can fail. So basically we are seeing how it has failed, what is its appearance, whether what is responsible for this failure, all that will be studied under different modes of failure. So let's go to characteristics or parameters of failure mode. So generally a failure is, when you say failure, it has got three characteristics to observe. So the first one is what is known as manifestation of failure. Manifestation means what is it appearing like, what is its output expression. So when you see at that with your naked eye, what you see is your manifestation, whether its length has increased, whether its shape has increased, whether there is a hole formation on that. All that external appearance comes under what is known as manifestation. Manifestation is basically its external appearance. So how the failure is showing itself at the outset, at the top. Now, basically it's answering the question, how has it failed? So that is the first characteristic. Okay, whether the deformation has increased, whether the material property has changed. The second aspect is the failure inducing agents. So what is causing the failure? So there are many factors, like the force may be responsible for the failure, or a temperature may be responsible for the failure. So all the parameters that are responsible for the failure also have to be seen in this characteristic. And the third option is, or third characteristic is, the location of failure. Sometimes at the component, the top and the surface itself, you'll be able to see the failure. There is a formation of crack or some hole, you'll be able to see that there has been a failure. But sometimes the failure may occur deep inside the material where you cannot see. So in such case, we'll say failure is occurring at the inside of the body. So to classify that, we will see where is it occurred, whether it has occurred on the top surface, whether it has occurred inside the body. So basically, to summarize, we have three things. How is it appearing? That we call it as manifestation. And who is responsible? That we call it as failure inducing agent. And where is it occurring? So that we call it as location of failure. So three parameters will decide what kind of mode or what kind of failure that component is undergoing. To get into more details, when we say appearance of the failure, so it is an outward expression of something happening inside. If somebody is crying, we will say there is is feeling pain inside, there is a grief inside. So the pain or grief is appearing in terms of is crying. So crying is an outward expression of the pain inside a person. Similarly, so when you see a body, you may see that it has enlarged too much. So that is an outward expression. So what are the different outward expressions, different ways in which body expresses itself when it has failed, comes under what is known as manifestation. Manifestation is the outward expression. When you look at the body, a failed body, with a bare naked eyes, you will be able to see different characteristics, and these characteristics are called manifestation. So we basically have four types of manifestations that we can classify. The first one is elastic deformation. Elastic deformation is nothing but a change in the shape, size, or dimensions of a component. With this dimension, the original length or a dimension has increased. But one good thing is about elastic deformation, it is recoverable. Because it is elastic, so you can recover the deformation back. When you remove the load, it will come back to this original position. When we say elastic deformation, the failure has occurred because it's supposed to, say, extend by 2 mm. Okay, but somehow because of the external load, it has extended to 3 mm. So that means it, because of this extra 1 mm, it is not able to perform its intended function. So we say it has failed. This failure is basically because of this extra 1 mm deformation that we did not want it to happen. So whenever there is a elastic deformation, a large amount of change in size because of the elastic nature, then we say it's a elastic deformation. Then we have plastic deformation. Again, plastic deformation is also similarly, it is change in length, the dimensions, or the size of the body. Only thing is, this is not recoverable. So this we say the plastic deformation is permanent. So whenever there is a permanent deformation, there is a change in the atomic structure in the material. And even when you remove the load, the body will not come to this original position. So such deformations, we call it as plastic deformation. So in some cases, this plastic deformation may be responsible for the failure of the components. In other words, this plastic deformation is responsible for the system not to perform. Okay. So, and the third one is a fracture or rupture. Rupture or fracture basically means when a component, okay, breaks into two or more parts, we call it as fracture. So because of this fracture, the system is now not able to perform its intended function. So it is not able to do its job. So when we say the system is not able to perform because it has fractured, then we say the reason is a fracture. So fracture is one of the occurrence. By looking at the breakage of the component or a system, we'll say it has fractured. Sometimes, so all these things will be fine. So there is no elastic deformation, there is no plastic deformation, there is no fracture. However, it is material properties have undergone a change. So for example, its Young's modulus has changed now. So because of this change in Young's modulus, it is not able to perform. So this comes under a category known as material change or material properties change. So whenever there is a change in material property because of which the component is not performing its intended job, we say the manifestation is shown, its appearance is shown in terms of these material changes. When you say metallurgical, when you look at the material, inside of the material through a microscope, or metallurgically when you observe the inside thing, inside structure of a material, you will see there has been some change, materials properties have changed. So that comes under metallurgical changes. Now we have chemical changes. Sometimes because of chemical actions, a new chemical is formed or existing chemical properties have changed. So whenever such things happen, we call it as chemical change. And the last one is nuclear change. Whenever the change is observed in terms of the subatomic level, at the atom level, below the atom level, then we say it is a change at the atomic level. So material change may be because of the metallurgical change or chemical change or nuclear change. All these things will result in the change in the material property. Because of this change in material property, it is not able to perform its intended function. So to summarize, the external appearance may be, you may find elastic deformation more than necessary, or you may find plastic deformation, which is also more than necessary. You may actually observe that a component has actually broken, it has fractured. Then we say fracture, third case. And fourth case, you might have observed that there is a change in material property. So in all these changes are now responsible for the failure. So these are the changes we can actually observe and visualize. So therefore we call it as, these are the types of manifestation of failure. So failure is showing up in one of these forms. that is elastic deformation, plastic deformation, fracture, rupture, or material change. So that's about types of manifestation. So once we see the appearance, we'll study what is responsible. So depending on the agent which has caused a failure, we again classify into four different types. The first one is force. Force may be responsible for the failure of the component. For example, if the intended force, we are supposed to apply 100 Newton, okay, but you have applied, let us say, another 50 Newton, so now it has become 150 Newton. So because the load has increased its limit, the component has failed. So in this case, who is responsible? The force is responsible for the failure of the components. There are different types of forces, okay. There may be steady force, there may be random force, there may be cyclic force. Force in all these forms, or one of these forms, is responsible for the failure. So force can be an agent of failure. That means force is responsible for failure. So that is first category. Second category is there may be temperature. Temperature is responsible for the failure of the component. Now how, when the temperature, we have designed a component to work under 30 degrees centigrade. Because of some reason, the temperature of the environment has increased to 70 degrees centigrade. Now at the 70 degrees centigrade, it has increased its length, its material properties have changed. So all these changes now have made this component incapable of doing its intended job. Then we say the component has failed, and this failure or failure is due to the change in the temperature. So that is the second reason. So temperature is also responsible for the failure. And the third reason is the time. So it may be surprising to know that time can also lead to failure. So time can be a short time or a long time. For example, if you study what is known as creep, later you will see that creep. So in creep, what is happening? So there is a component, and we have applied some load, okay? And now the deformation is, let us say, 1 mm extra. So its deformation is, let's say, 2 mm, and we are okay with it. Now after, if you leave the component for, let us say, a year and come back and see, now its length has increased to 3 mm. So during that 1 year, you have not applied any extra load, but still the component has changed its length. So this we call it as the effect of time. Due to time, the dimensions has changed. And the fourth reason could be environment. So reactive environment may be responsible for the failure of the component. Maybe it changes the material properties, and material property change is responsible for the failure or inability of the component to do its intended job. So thus there can be four different types of agents responsible for it. So one is the force, another one is temperature, and the one is time, and the reactive environment. So one of these causes or all the causes may be responsible for the failure. So therefore we call these are the failure inducing agents. So these are the parameters that are responsible for the failure. And the last characteristic of a failure is, where is it occurring? So there are two types, body type that and surface type. Let us see what is the surface type. So whenever you see a failure, you can see the failure, let's say formation of a crack or a hole, it is occurring on the surface. So it is visible to you, okay? So that means, and probably it has shown a wear behavior. So some of the material has eroded at the top surface. So that is easily identifiable as a failure. Suppose we wanted a smooth surface, but because of wear or due to corrosion, the material has degraded. So then we say material failure has occurred. Whereas it has occurred on the surface. So such failures which are occurring on the surface of the body, we call it as surface type failures. Sometimes failure may occur inside the body, may not always be visible. So when it's inside the body, we say it is body type failure. So there are two types, that is on the surface or within the body. So these are the three parameters. One is manifestation, how is it appearing? And second is reasons, who is responsible for it? And third one is location. So these three parameters will define the nature of failure. Now let us get into the different modes of mechanical failure. So as an engineer, it is our responsibility to understand the different ways in which a component can fail so that we can take effective prevention. So knowing the failure is the first step in stopping the failure, that is preventing the failure. Now let us see different modes of mechanical failures. The first one is force or temperature or both induced elastic deformation. Now whenever we design a component, we design for a particular elastic deformation. Now let us take a body and it is allowed to deform only 2 mm. Now when you apply more load, the deformation cross this 2 mm and may touch the surrounding casing, then it will not perform its intended job. So whenever elastic deformation is responsible for the failure of the component, we categorize under force or temperature induced elastic deformation. Of course, when we say temperature induced, temperature can also be responsible for this elastic deformation. So as we have already discussed, elastic deformation is basically a deformation which is recoverable after load is removed. However, the deformation is so large during the operation of the component, it may obstruct the functioning and may stop the system. So it is possible that elastic deformation may be responsible for the failure. So then we have yielding. As we have discussed already, yielding is a permanent deformation. It's permanent, it is not recoverable like a elastic deformation. And when this occurs, whenever the stress is more than the yield point stress of the material. So when the stress is equal to or more than the yield point of the material, you will find the material undergoes large deformation without any increase in the stress. Of course, there is a stress, but you are not increasing any stress. So even though you are not increasing any stress, you will find the component length is increasing drastically. This is because what is known as spastic deformation. So whenever this large deformation, which is permanent in nature, is responsible for the failure, we categorize it under failure due to yielding. And the third one is Brinelling. Brinelling is a permanent deformation or indentation of a bearing surface. Okay, and these are commonly observed in rolling surfaces of bearing raceways. So this occurs due to contact stresses between two mating surfaces, and the stresses developed at the mating surfaces become more than the yield point of the material, and this leaves a sort of elliptical indentation on the surface. So there is a dent formation. So such formation we call it as Brinelling. And then we have ductile fracture and brittle fracture. So what is fracture? Is separation of a component into two or more parts. So there is a component and it has broken into two parts or three parts. So whenever this occurs, we call it as it has fractured. Now when a component has failed, we can observe two things. So what was the deformation at the time of failure? If you find the deformation is very large before failure, then we say it has failed due to ductile rupture or ductile fracture. In some cases, the component might have failed with little or no deformation. So then we say it has failed due to brittle fracture. So most of the metals like steel, mild steel, you will see they undergo a lot of deformation before they actually fail. Sometimes this is useful. When you see a deformation, you can say it is going to fail and you can easily replace the components. Therefore, ductile fractures give a sort of warning to us. Whereas certain materials like cast iron or ceramics, they will fail without giving any warning. Okay, there is no large deformation. There is small deformation which is not visible to ordinary eyes. So in that case, we say it has undergone little deformation before failure, and such deformations or such failures are called as brittle fracture. So the deformation that has occurred before the failure will determine whether it is a ductile failure or ductile rupture or a brittle fracture. Then we have fatigue. Basically it's a failure due to cyclic loading. Now when you take a component, okay, and you apply certain loads, let's plot stress versus time. So in most of the cases, the stress remains constant in static loading. But in fatigue, it may so happen that there is a change in stress. So it is 0, and sometimes it increase, it is 0, and then it increases to, let us say, 100 Newton. Again it becomes 0 and comes to minus 100 Newton. Again it goes to 0 plus 100 Newton, like this whenever there is a variation of load. And you can also observe this maximum stress, okay? The maximum stress in this variation is below the yield point stress of the material. So we expect component not to fail because the maximum stress is below the yield point. However, it is observed that when there is a cyclic variation of stress, the component fails even though the maximum stress is below the yield point stress. Such behavior, such failures are known as fatigue. Fatigue is basically formation of crack and subsequent fracture due to the cyclic variation of the stress when the stress is well below the yield point stress. This fatigue can be of different types, okay? Most commonly we call it as high cycle fatigue and low cycle fatigue. So how to distinguish? These are the fatigue phenomena in which the component has failed with less number of cycles. If you say low cycle fatigue, it has failed with, let us say, less than 10,000. If the cycles are less than, so if you see this figure, this entire thing will form one cycle, okay? From here, one wave, okay, another wave. So each wave is one cycle. So if you see the component has failed by undergoing only cycles less than 10,000, we say it as low cycle failure. So because it has undergone, it has failed with very less number of cycles, we say there is a high stress. So the low cycle fatigue is always identified with high stress. Okay, and because the stress is high, you can also see the stress strain curve, what is known as SN curve, is not well defined for low cycle fatigue. Whereas if you go to high cycle fatigue is a fatigue in which a component fails after undergoing more than 10,000 cycles of loading. And as you can see, because it is taking large amount of load cycles, you can understand the stress is very low or relatively less. So when the stress is less, and normally we go for SN curve, what is known as stress and number of cycles. So to differentiate, low cycle is the one which undergoes failure when the load cycle is below 10,000. High cycle means when the component fails after surviving a load cycles of at least 10,000. So this 10,000 is not a fixed one, it is approximate number of cycles. Then we have thermal fatigue. So here we have seen the stress is varying, okay, and this variation of stress is responsible for the fatigue. So that is your low cycle or high cycle fatigue. So instead, if temperature varies, instead of sigma, if you have temperature, okay, if temperature is varying and this variation in temperature is responsible for the failure, we call it as thermal fatigue. Surface fatigue, as the name indicates, the fatigue has occurred only on the surface. Usually what happens, this is observed in case of rollings. Okay, if two bodies are rolling in rolling contact, at the point of contact, we get what is known as contact stress, or also called as Hurgen stress. So because of rolling, each point is undergoing a different value of stress. Okay, the contact stress values change at this point. So this variation in the contact stress is responsible for a failure known as surface fatigue. Then we have impact fatigue. Impact basically means a large amount of force, okay, and applied over a short period of time. So when this impact is repeatedly occurring on the surface, we call it as the fatigue due to impact fatigue. And then we have corrosion fatigue. It's a regular fatigue phenomena in which the environment is corrosive. So fatigue that is occurring in presence of corrosive environment, we call it as corrosion fatigue. Then we have what is known as fretting fatigue. So this fretting occurs, once again, let us define here itself. What is fretting? Fretting is, let me erase these things. So whenever you see two surfaces are in contact and they are held in contact by application of the normal forces. So you apply a force like this so that they are attached to each other and they are not supposed to move relatively. However, because of some variation in load, it is possible these two may slide with respect to each other. So even though you don't want to have a relative motion, sometimes because of variation in load, you will find there is a relative sliding motion. So when you say relative sliding motion between two surfaces held together by a normal force, we call it as fretting phenomena. The one specialty of this variation is these are very small amplitude. They are varying like this. It's moving this way, this way, this way. So from here to here, they are moving this fashion. And this amplitude is very, very less. So it could be less than 100 micrometer. So such a small variation, relative sliding, we call it as fretting. So whenever, because of this phenomenon of fretting, if you find fatigue occurring, we call it as that fatigue is due to fretting fatigue. So basically it is a fatigue which is caused due to fretting. Now let us define what is known as corrosion. We can define corrosion as deterioration or degradation of material due to chemical or electrochemical reaction with its environment. So corrosion is nothing but degradation in the material properties due to chemical or electrochemical reactions. So whenever the material properties are degraded due to the chemical or electrochemical reaction, we call it as corrosion. Now this corrosion can be of different types again. The first one is known as a direct chemical attack. As the name indicates, here a chemical is directly in contact with the material surface, and this chemical is responsible for the degradation of the material. So when the material is removed, the layer below this is also exposed. So whenever the chemical is directly involved in the degradation of the surface of the material, we call it as direct chemical attack. The second one is, we have what is known as galvanic corrosion. Galvanic corrosion happens when two dissimilar metals, which are connected via a corrosive medium and becoming part of an electric circuit, you will see a galvanic corrosion. For example, we have two dissimilar metals. Okay, this is a metal A and metal B. And now they are connected via a corrosive medium, let us say a corrosive liquid. And then these two metals are now connected via an electric circuit. So when two dissimilar metals, they are connected via a corrosive medium and part of an electric circuit, so there will be flow of electrons from one material to other material, and thus the material degradation occurs. So this degradation is known as galvanic corrosion. Then we have pitting corrosion. In pitting corrosion, it's again due to chemical reaction. What is happening is, on the surface, you will see large number of small holes formed on the metal surface. So such phenomena is called pitting corrosion. So in intergranular corrosion, the corrosion is targeting at the granular boundaries. So if there are two grains here, at the boundaries of these two, there is an attack by the chemical. So such attacks or such degradations are known as intergranular corrosion. And then we have selective leaching. As the name indicates, there is a selective removal of a material. Okay, one particular material or a particular element is removed. For example, if you talk about what is known as de-zincification. Okay, so there is something called as de-zincification. So what happens in de-zincification? It involves removal of zinc atoms from the brass alloys. So because of chemical, what is happening is zinc's atoms have been removed from the brass. Okay. So when this happens, we only selectively the zinc has been removed. So hence the word selective leaching. An example is de-zincification. Then we have erosion corrosion. Erosion basically means removal of the material. So when a liquid flows, okay, on the surface, so it is flowing on the surface, okay, and this liquid has got some abrasive material, so hard materials. So the liquid which contains abrasive material, when it flows over the surface, okay, and it is creating a degradation of the material, and this phenomena is known as erosion corrosion. Then we have what is known as a cavitation corrosion. Okay, in cavitation corrosion, let us say, what is cavitation? So let's say we have got a pipe and a fluid is flowing from high pressure point to low pressure point. So whenever there is a flow of liquid from high pressure to low pressure, there is a sudden burst occurring at this location. So because of this bursting, the inside surface of this pipe or a material gets eroded or corroded. So when this happens due to the phenomenon is called cavitation, okay? The sudden burst of fluid is called cavitation, and because of cavitation, there is a degradation, we call it as cavitation corrosion. Then we have hydrogen damage. As the name indicates, it's a damage due to hydrogen effect on metals. For example, in hydrogen embrittlement, okay, the metal becomes brittle due to the diffusion of hydrogen into the material. So there is something called as hydrogen embrittlement. In hydrogen embrittlement, so in the material, the hydrogen gets diffused. Because of diffusion of this hydrogen, this material becomes brittle. So when it loses its property, so therefore this phenomena is called hydrogen damage. And then we have two more corrosion types, that is biological corrosion and stress corrosion. In biological corrosion, as the name indicates, living organisms, when they have their waste product, the waste product is a chemical, and when it falls on the material surface, the resulting corrosion is called biological corrosion. And as the name indicates, stress corrosion is stress, the usual stress plus a corrosive media, together they are responsible for the degradation of the material. So when these things happen, we call it as stress corrosion. Now let us define what is known as wear, progressive loss of material from the two surfaces in relative sliding motion. The loss of material is mostly due to mechanical action. So what is important here is, in wear there is a loss of material. Material is removed from the metal or the material. This loss is due to the mechanical action. Mechanical action, that means there is a force involved. Some kind of rubbing, some kind of plowing, all these mechanical forces are involved. If it results in a removal of the material, we call it as wear. Where there are two important types, and however we have listed many other types also. The first one is known as adhesive wear. So what is happening in adhesive wear is the most common and basic type of wear. So if you take the two surfaces in contact, there are two surfaces. If you zoom it, actually you will find that there are something called as asperities. So there are rough surfaces between this. Okay, so when they are in motion, okay, when they are in motion and when there is a pressure load applied, okay, the asperities which are in contact each other, so they, because there is a large amount of force over a small area, they actually yield. Because of this yielding, they get welded. Okay, and when there is a relative motion, a part of it, the asperity, say let us say this is material A, this is material B, okay, this is material B. So the part of material B gets attached to the material A, okay, and there is a breakage at the asperities or the mountain like structures. And then after some time, the extra material of B which has got attached to A will subsequently be removed. So when this happens, we call it is adhesive wear, because the word adhesive comes because they are getting attached to each other. There is a micro welding occurring at the contact point between these two. So because there is a adhesion, the joining and then subsequent removal of material, we call it as adhesive wear. Then we have abrasive wear. So it's again a mechanical removal process. Okay, here what is happening, there is something called as a plowing and gouging action. When you are digging it, basically you're digging this asperities, no, that I have talked about. They are digging the material, okay, they are removing the material by actually plowing, okay. So when this happens, so we say it is abrasive. They are physically, they are removing the material by contact. Sometimes it is possible that in between two surfaces there may be some hard material, okay. When the hard material gets stuck in this, so during the relative motion, this hard material will remove the material from the second body. So either the asperities of the first body or any hard material removes the material by physical mechanical action, like such as plowing and gouging, we say it is abrasive, because there is abrasion occurring, and because of abrasion there is a removal of material, we call it as abrasive wear. And of course the next we have corrosive wear. So as we said, corrosion is responsible for the degradation of the material, and this corrosion will subsequently remove the material from the surface, and this loss of material which is due to the corrosion is called corrosive wear. And surface fatigue wear, it is a common wear mechanism seen in gears, okay, and other mechanisms where there is a rolling is occurring. The alternating stress from the rolling contact are responsible for cracking and forming a wear pit on the surface. So whenever you see this kind of wear pit, we say it is surface fatigue wear. And then we have impact wear. As we already discussed, impact is application of large amount of force over a short period of time. When there is repeated exposure to dynamic loads, the resulting wear is known as impact wear. So fretting wear, as we discussed already, fretting, whenever there is a fretting, because of this fretting, if the material removal happens, we call it as fretting wear. So wear is the removal of material, and fretting is actually a small relative motion between two surfaces, as we discussed already. Then we go to impact. Impact is a sudden blow or sudden load applied for a short period of time. It's kind of a dynamic load. Like dynamic, basically it is a function of time. So it is there for a short period of time and then it goes off. So this is known as impact. And in impact, we have again different types. First one is impact fracture. So as I said, fracture is separation of component into two or more particles. So one particular big component has split into two parts or three parts or in number of parts. So when this fracture is occurring because of the impact load, we call it as impact fracture. Similarly, we have deformation. So the large amount of deformation has occurred due to the sudden application of load or sudden impact. So such deformation is known as impact deformation. Similarly, impact wear is also possible, that is removal of the material is also possible. And impact can also lead to fatigue, and also fretting can also cause fatigue, okay, that is failure of the component due to cyclic load. Fretting can also cause wear, that is removal of material from the surface in contact. Fretting can also occur in presence of corrosive medium, and then we call it as fretting corrosion. So fretting, fatigue, wear and corrosions. And then we have what is known as creep. Is accumulation of plastic deformation over a period of time under the influence of high temperature or constant stress. So with the time, we will find when the bodies are at certain high temperature, okay, the temperature is very large. So over the period of time, you will see that the length, the deformation has increased. Even though you are not increasing the load, the length has increased. Such phenomena we call it as creep. And then we have thermal relaxation, or also known as stress relaxation. Due to high temperature creep, gradually a component may lose its stress and strain and may result in failure. And this is known as thermal relaxation. And then we have stress rupture. So in stress rupture, it is nothing but a fracture of the component in presence of a large amount of stress. And the thermal shock, next we have thermal shock. In thermal shock, the temperature gradient in the material may result in each part into its large deformation. At some point, these stresses and strains may exceed the material strength, leading to the formation of crack and subsequent failure. Then we have galling and seizure. Galling is basically a plowing action, okay, or gouging action, or it could be a welding and then tearing. So those are the major mechanical actions. When two surfaces are acting like this, so when two surfaces are, there is a gouging, they are removing the material, this asperities of this material A are removing the material from B, and there is some or there could be some welding occurring, micro welding. So all these mechanical things are happening, and because of which, for example, if the two parts are actually, they were moving, because of this micro welding or the material being stuck in between, there is a kind of seizure and there is no longer relative motion possible. So such seizure, which is because of this mechanical action, is known as galling and seizure. Spelling is, so they are related basically. So there is a small asperity, okay, the material. So this, whenever this material is removed from its parent material, we call it as spelling. It is to be noted, these things are not independent, okay. Then we have radiation damage. It's nothing but loss in the material properties due to the presence or exposure to radiation. So plastics, you know, typically lose their properties due to radiation. So when they're exposed to radiation, they lose their properties. And buckling is basically a sudden change in shape, usually under compressive load. So imagine there is a slender structure, you're applying load, all of a sudden it starts bending, sudden bending due to the increase in the compressive load. So that we call it as buckling. And this buckling may be sometimes due to creep, and we call it as creep buckling. And as we already discussed, stress corrosion is a corrosion in presence, or stress failure in presence of corrosion. And corrosion can also lead to wear, corrosion can also lead to fatigue, and there can be a combined action of creep, fatigue, and these two can act leading to failure. So these are some of the modes that are observed, that can be observed in common. So it's not that they're all independent. Sometimes, as you can see, corrosion, fatigue is also occurring, corrosion is also occurring. So these two may be joined together, you know, they are acting in consonance. So these are not independent, but we are studying just for the sake of clarity, we are studying as a separate failure mode.